And we are going to record. Great. So with recording this meeting, it is a public meeting. And moving forward, we will end up doing it. We might have to do it a little bit different format because this is supposed to be open for the public to view. That is something that we are working through, kind of in the process in the way that we will do that moving forward. These meetings will also eventually be hosted on the city's website or links to them, so people can view and watch what goes on and what we're working towards here with the natural hazard mitigation plan updates. So you are all hopefully here for the natural hazard mitigation plan update, and we are joined today by a number of you throughout the organization and throughout our community. And then we are joined by Cynthia and Marion from DLCD, who are going to be some of our primary plan writers. And Cynthia is definitely very happy she's here to help us and really take the reins on a lot of this because this is what she does. For the rest of us, the best thing we can do is make sure that we're participating, we're engaged. We take the time to provide useful and insightful content and comments on everything as we go forward. With that, Cynthia, do you want to get started? Or should I do a little, also actually real quick, if you can open the chat and you can just throw in your name and which organization you're representing, that would be really helpful for us as we keep our records on this. You will also see that we do have our live subtitles going on there. So if anybody else, if anybody needs any content like that, please let us know, recordings or otherwise. And we will do our best to accommodate. And all right, Cynthia.
Great. Thanks, Greg. My name is Cynthia Smith with Deschutes. I came from Deschutes. I was afraid I'd do that. From Oregon Department of Land Conservation and Development, I am going to be the project manager on this project, working with Greg. And hopefully everybody can see my screen. Some of you have gone through a natural hazards mitigation plan before, some of you haven't. So for those who have gone through this before, just bear with me. I'm gonna try to give a general overview to everybody to tell you what we're gonna be going through between now and hopefully finishing up by June of 2023. So our objectives here, we're gonna do some, well, I think because there's quite a bit of people, we might skip the introductions, but you're more than welcome to answer some of the questions that I'm going to pose to you in the chat, and then Greg can make record of those, and we can we'll collect all that information later. Our objective also is to go through the purpose and the process, the roles of you as participants. We're going to need some input on public engagement strategy today, and then what your next steps are. Oops, sorry about that. So intros, if you want to put your name, if you haven't done so already, put your name, title, and the department or organization that you are from. And then if you want to answer one or three of those questions in the chat, or you can also provide that possibly to Greg if he's willing to get all those emails, to just mention what kind of experience or interest or concerns you might have with this project. Possibly what does your department or organization bring to the process? And how does this plan relate to your role in your department or organization? And since we're going to skip that, I'll just move on. Instead of doing it orally, we'll just have you do it in the chat. So the purpose and the process of a natural hazards mitigation plan is, well, first of all, by definition, a hazard mitigation is any sustained action taken to reduce or eliminate the long-term risk to human life and property from hazards. You can see there on the screen, City of Salem's mitigation mission statement there is very similar in regards to that. And mitigation reduces the potential for disaster and is most effective at the state and the local level. So that's why we are convening you to help update this. So the Federal Emergency Management Agency, also known as FEMA, requires that a natural hazards mitigation plan be updated every 5 years. And a current FEMA-approved natural hazards mitigation plan is a key factor to establishing eligibility for certain FEMA grants that fund natural hazard planning and projects. So if you have a mitigation project that needs funding, this is a good reason why. It also provides a foundation for guiding risk reduction investments. It builds community resilience to future natural hazard events. Examples of projects include retrofitting critical facilities, elevating homes, or removing them from the floodplain, and requiring fire-resistant roofing in wildfire hazard areas. There are some guiding principles in the natural hazard mitigation process, updating process. We're going to plan and invest in the future. We're going to look at your community assets, the population, your built environment, the natural environment, and your economy, and where those intersect with natural hazards. We're going to be looking at past and present experiences and future projections. We want to collaborate and engage early. If you are in the planning department, this kind of coincides with the Oregon land use planning. We want to involve citizens of your community and the whole community. And this is also great for integrating community planning for the unique needs of the city of Salem. The project has several components to it. I'll just try to go over these at high level so you understand what we'll be going through. I got to move my Zoom thing here. So the planning process, this is something that we are going to be tracking from start to finish. We want to know how the plan is developed, who was involved, how they were invited, what event happened, what data and information is used. It's all about documenting some more. Greg's going to talk about a little bit later, about the website that's been established. We're also going to have a public engagement process throughout the process and prior to adoption, among other things. So the risk assessment is the next phase. We are going to be identifying the hazards that are applicable to the city of Salem. We're going to be looking at previous occurrences and the future probability. We're going to be looking at your vulnerabilities at the city of Salem and the potential consequences, and a little plug here, also looking at repetitive damage for national flood insurance insured structures. We work with Oregon Department of Geology and Mineral Industries for a risk report, the DOGAMI risk report. And I always forget what this one stands for, Oregon Climate Change Research Institute, also known as OCRI. We look at for a climate change report. These reports have already been done for Marion County. We will be leaning on Marion County's reports. And if one gets done for Polk County, we may be working with their report as well. But the DOGAMI report covers all of City of Salem, the OCRI report covers all or part of the city of Salem. This is a great time after the risk assessment for public review, and we're going to talk about that in a little bit. Then we move on to mitigation strategy. So everything we've done at the risk assessment is going to contribute to the mitigation strategy. We're going to be looking at the city of Salem and your authorities, your ordinances, policies, and resources, and the ability to expand them or improve upon them. We're going to create some mitigation goals on how to reduce and avoid long-term vulnerabilities. From there, we create mitigation actions. But first, we want to look at updating our current actions in the current plan, and then compile a comprehensive list of actions. And then it ends with an action plan, how we're going to prioritize those actions and how we're going to implement them. It's a couple best practices. We do a cost-benefit analysis, but not too hardcore. And then we also use a multivariable assessment, Stapley or Stapley, however people wanted to call that. If you're not familiar with it, it stands for social, technical, administrative, political, legal, economic, and environmental. So a multivariable assessment there. This is also a great opportunity once we get a draft done of the strategy for public review. Oops, sorry about that. We also want to demonstrate in our plan how we're going to maintain this plan, how we're going to continue the public participation. We're going to need to have a schedule and method put together of keeping the plan current, and how, if necessary or if applicable, to integrate into planning mechanisms. Since this is a plan update, we're going to really need to look at the changes that have occurred in development and land use and population, and also if the city has any changes in priorities in progress. So we'll be recording those as well. Plan adoption. So I handle a bit of this with some consultation with the steering committee. We first submit to the Oregon Department of Emergency Management. They may request some revisions. I may consult the steering committee for revisions and Greg. Once OEM is good with that, we would submit to FEMA. They may request some revisions. They will eventually issue an approval pending adoption letter. Once that happens, Greg is going to shepherd that process to the city council and get that formally adopted, the natural hazard mitigation plan adopted by the city council. And then once that happens, FEMA will issue a final approval. Draft schedule, right now we're in the organizing phase. We're gonna work a little bit on public engagement strategy today, but we have an intergovernmental agreement signed and a scope of work with some target dates established. We'll then move on to our hazard vulnerability assessment, mitigation strategy, and we hope to have this submitted to the state by June. This is a pretty quick turnaround, so we'll see how this goes. On for a ride. So this is kind of just a rough picture of our schedule. We're basically right in there around September, October, and we've got a lot of stuff condensed here in the next several months. Let's see, my screen is, So any questions before I go on to roles of participants? Greg, let me know if you see anybody.
Certainly. Just great comments so far in the chat. Some, you know, the climate action plan and the comprehensive plan, both we have representatives that support both of those plans here. So really happy to have them here, as well as everybody else that's joined so far. Otherwise, no questions at this time. So let's continue on. Thank you.
Great. So all of you who are here today, thank you. We greatly appreciate it. Right. Greg, you're going to be your convener and project lead. I am your project manager. We'll have a steering committee, which is comprised of the City of Salem's department delegates or alternates. And then we have interested parties, or we could call them stakeholders and representatives of the whole community. So in a little more detail, Greg will be leading and organizing, managing this process, and I will be there to assist. He'll also provide any county assessor information, or he'll maybe delegate that to somebody else to get that information. Like I said before, he'll shepherd that plan through once we get that approval pending adoption from FEMA, and then he'll also help carry out some responsibilities. I'll also manage the process by providing some agendas and follow-up actions in the schedule, and I will write the plan. There is a chance that some of you will help with writing the plan, and so we'll cross that road when we get there. Typically, we track and report cost share. This is a discussion I will continue in a little bit. So before this all happened, the City of Salem City Council approved the intergovernmental agreement to work with Oregon Department of Land Conservation and Development. And the scope of work goes into detail of the FEMA requirements. So if you have a chance, we'll probably upload this to the program that we use so you can review it. Goes into more detail of what FEMA requires. This is an agreement also that assures that the city understands that they're going to adopt the final plan in the end. And typically it would let the city council know that there is a cost share component, but we don't have that, and I'll explain that in a minute. The steering committee, you are the city department heads or department representatives who have been delegated authority to make these decisions for the city. And if you have alternates, that is wonderful, because there may be a time when you can't make it, and an alternate is going to be to everybody's benefit. We expect you to attend and participate actively, track your time. I'll talk about that in a minute. Provide any data. You know, the planning department or the building department is going to have great information on those permits. You might be from another department that has other great information. We're going to be leaning on you to help provide those plans, reports, maps. We're going to also help for you, ask for your support to execute the public engagement plan, communicate with your constituents and community members who may not be able to attend these meetings, provide comments, and provide other support for the project as identified in the scope of work. Now, stakeholders and interested parties, some of you are here. These are your community lifelines. And if you're not familiar with them, I always have to remember myself. That's your safety and security, your food, water, and shelter, health and medical, energy, communications, transportation, and hazardous materials. So some of you are here today, and thank you for being here. Our interested parties and stakeholders also include neighboring communities. I don't know, I think City of Kaiser was invited and City of Turner, thank you. And also Marion County and Polk County. Academia, businesses, I think some of you are here today as well. Even more importantly, are the representatives for underserved communities and the socially vulnerable populations, among others that are on this list. Now, the discussion item we have up next is, who are we missing? Who else do we need to represent the community? Here are some questions and some examples, questions on the left. So we could open up some dialogue. If you can think of anybody that you did not see on the list and you didn't mention to Greg previously, because I know he asked for your input, this would be a great time to mention, or you could also put it in the chat. So we'll just pause for a minute, and if anybody has any other suggestions of who we might be missing, who we need.
Very happy to take any open comment here, but also if you do have contact information for somebody specific, please either email it to me or put it in the chat so we can make sure that we capture that. And as this is a public meeting, if you feel like they wouldn't want their information going out publicly, please make sure you email it to me. That will be very helpful as we continue to build our team and get more people involved.
Okay, I'm gonna I'll let Greg manage the chat. I don't see, it doesn't look like we're seeing anybody chime in right now. There's.
Thank you, Patricia. I did invite somebody from Marion Polk Food Share, as well as Salem Health Hospitals and a few other organizations that did not end up joining us today. That's okay. We will continue to include them on all of our updates and any information we send out. So if you do have organizations that you think may not want to be involved, but be interested or be included, just on updates in general, please again provide me that information and we will we'll get them involved as well. And Randy, I see your comment about dialysis. I did invite one of the facility managers for DaVita, but I have not heard anything back from them. But I will reach out again and try to make sure that they are included. Actually, I should probably reach out to their new regional manager. So thank you for bringing that up.
Great. Thanks, everybody. So cost share. I just want to give you a background so you can understand a little bit about these grants that we typically work with. So normally FEMA grants that make it possible for Oregon Department of Land Conservation and Development to assist jurisdictions like the City of Salem with these updates require a 25% non-federal match. Participants are usually required to fill out a form like you see on this slide and identify you know, how they either time or other eligible expenses. And we collect those and so that's typically how it is. So, but then during the Federal Consolidation Appropriations Act, it was applied to this grant for the Salem update, and therefore it lowers that match from 25% to 10%. This is a one-time reduction. But then the Oregon Legislature's House Bill 5006, enacted in 2021 regular session, provided additional funding to cover the remaining 10%. So this is also a one-time appropriation. So due to the generosity of the federal government and the state of Oregon legislature, the City of Salem does not need to do a cost share documentation. It kind of relieves some of the pressure off of all of us. However, the City of Salem, if you are a staff member with the city, we do need to have you track your time and record it appropriately. And Greg is going to send out a follow-up email to all of you to identify the code that you need to be listing your time for this project. So still for the City of Salem employees, make sure you do track your time on this project. So, Greg, do you have anything else on that?
No, thank you very much. That is correct. I am working with finance to get us our code so we can track our time appropriately. And any other organization that is participating, I will obviously record that you were participating here during these meetings, especially if it's public record. Please, if you have more than one person in the room, please let me know that so we can accurately account for their time as well.
Great. So one a program that we use, a document sharing program, is called Box. I don't know how many people are familiar with Box. It's pretty simple to use. I wasn't familiar with it before I came here. It's kind of like Dropbox, if you're familiar with Dropbox, but it's just Box, a simple box. You can download documents, upload documents, you can edit documents. However, we do not want you to edit documents with Box tools. We would rather you download, edit, and then upload with the same name. Box program has great version control. So what I'm going to be doing either later today or early next week is I'm going to be sending out an invitation to all of you. And you're going to get two emails. One is going to be an automatically generated one, and then there's going to be another one from me. So that will be your invitation to come in and use Box. So the files that you see there is just the front page of the City of Salem files that I've created, where some documents are in phase one, and phase two we'll be working primarily out of. But if you have any other references or images that you want to upload, you can do that, and it's going to help through this process. So any questions before I go on to the public engagement strategy? Or anything in chat?
Nothing in chat at this time. We did get a message from Patricia that we did an OCCRI risk assessment as part of the climate action plan, and she'll send that information over. So yep, that may save us a little bit of time as we move forward.
Great. And we'll also look at Marion County's. I can't remember if they covered City Salem, but I do know the Dogami report covered all of Salem. So that's great.
And Kathleen Silva is on. I see she's on her phone. So Kathleen, if you can either send a message about that or confirm or deny, we would appreciate that. Otherwise, we can look for that in the future.
I know I have the report. I don't know who it covers at this time. Still getting through all of our volumes to have them read. So
yeah,
I'll have to follow up with you in a later time.
Okay.
And
thank
I have,
you very much.
Yep. And we have access to that. My colleagues are working with Kathleen on the finishing up Marion County's projects. So public engagement. I think we all understand the benefits of public involvement. More than anything, it's going to strengthen the community disaster resilience. It's going to educate your community members about hazards and risk. Of course, it's going to bring in different perspectives and improve the plan quality. So we all know that. So putting in on our thinking caps, we want to think about how we want to engage the public in this. Engaging the public is first and foremost with FEMA's requirements. Some of the suggestions that we'll make is that it's sometimes great to have some kind of a public event at the beginning of the project to inform people what is happening and why. After the risk assessment draft, and then maybe is done, and then we can solicit for comments. Same thing with mitigation strategy. And then when the whole draft is done before we submit it to the state of Oregon, we can post that online. So we want your input. How can we reach the community, the constituency that you represent? What's the best way to engage your public? And how can we improve awareness? So examples on the right-hand side, we will be noticing our steering committee meetings to the public, open to the public. So that's one, it's gonna put a feather in our cap. FEMA doesn't require steering committee meetings to be noticed or in public, but we're gonna have them that way. And then we also have a website and social media, which I'll show you in a minute. The last update, they did a survey. I think a survey is, fair game to do again. We probably just want to get some fresh numbers on that. News articles, maybe a presentation to the city council. These are all ideas. Maybe a presentation to a specific group or at a fair. I know, you know, of course, the community, the county fairs and the state fair have already gone by. There's the holiday fair coming up, and who wants to know about hazards during the holiday fair? It's so happy and joyous. But if we recall, you know, that crazy wildfire that went through the Denver metro area was right around Christmas. So it doesn't hurt to open people's eyes even at a holiday fair. So that's another option. We could put together some flyers that we could post in the, you know, the community centers, the library, the swimming pools, you know, the exercise, you know, what is it, community centers. So if you could, if you have any ideas, yeah, let's talk about them.
And Craig, I just want to say, I know, sure. I know that we have some meetings coming up, and this is kind of one of the bigger asks from all of our participating partners is that when we do go to public comment, when we do have it open, especially for feedback, that you support us with that. Whether you send it out to an organization, you get it posted somewhere, you share it on your social media. The more people we have that engage in this and provide effective feedback, the better plan we have. So I know we'll be sending it out in a multitude of ways as is, as a city. But any of our partner agencies that are joining us today, that is one of the biggest things you can do for us is continue to share that message, especially when we go to public comment. And then if you have any events that I can come sit at, or somebody can come sit and say, you know, talk to people about the natural hazard mitigation plan and updates and how they can be involved and participate and sign up for alerts when we do go to public comment. Actually, Eunice, I see you on here. I know we talked the other day about one of the public meetings that you're doing over at Fork 40. That might be something that I try to come sit there for a while and, you know, have a little natural hazard mitigation plan booth. So something like that, any of those public meetings where we're engaging the community, we're engaging people. That's what we're looking for in this. So if you have plans like that, you have events coming up, please let me know. Please let us know.
Anybody want to speak before I move on? I will. Go ahead.
Sorry, I just want to address Austin. You sent the question: is the purpose of outreach primarily to inform, or will there be a need for input? What level of influence do we expect those providing input to have? So they will go out for public comment, so people can say, "Hey, you completely, you know, you said these were our priority or our biggest emergency or biggest hazards." You completely missed asteroid impact. I'm going to knock on some wood because I have bad luck with that. But, you know, something like that, that, you know, we may have somebody from the public mention something or have an effective strategy as we get into that mitigation, right? We're going to a public comment essentially twice. Once when we look at what our hazards are and how we assess them and everything. And then once as we start to develop those mitigation strategies, is there something we completely missed? Or are there other participants that we need to be engaged with? So things like that. So inform, yes, that we're doing this, but also for people to provide meaningful and productive content and comments to our plan, right? We are representing the community. This plan is designed to support and improve our community. So having community input can be very, very important for us. Thank you.
Yeah, and they might think of a mitigation action that we weren't even thinking about. So in their neighborhood or elsewhere in the city. So yeah, great. That was a great question. Website. So this was went live. I don't know. We don't know when, but it's out there. So Greg's going to be responsible for keeping this going. We're going to have it updated. This is just a partial screenshot. This is, I think we'll put that link in the chat for everybody to look at and enjoy. But we're going to try to post our meetings here and our presentations in any, documents that come through for each meeting. And minutes, if we have meeting minutes, we'll definitely put that in there. Okay, any questions before we move on to, we're wrapping it up pretty quick here. Okay, let's see, let me check the chat. Oh, great, thanks, Greg. Okay, so next steps. We're in a pretty aggressive schedule here. We need to meet regularly, and we need to figure out if there is a day and a time each month to at least have some regular monthly meetings between October and December and then January to May. There may be a need for extra meetings, but if we could at least get one on the calendar a month, that would be great. So Greg, I don't know how you want to handle this, if we want to put this in the chat or if you want to handle people just emailing you what works, or if you want to do another doodle poll. We didn't talk about that before this meeting started.
We should have talked about that earlier. I'm sorry. So I will likely do another doodle poll for everyone. I think that's a pretty effective way of getting a consensus on time or a best case time. I think Thursdays generally work good because nobody likes to start off Monday with talking about disasters like I do. And most people don't want to end their Fridays talking about disasters as well. So I think we'll probably shoot for some Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday type meetings sometime during the day. I'll send out a doodle poll. John, thank you for commenting that worked well. And hopefully we can get a good consensus on at least having a majority of people come back for regular updates as we move forward with this plan. So I'll send that out here in the next day or potentially next week, which is also the OEMA conference. So we'll see if I can get that out tomorrow.
Yeah. And we want to start diving in as soon as we can, just because we have a short timeline to get this through. Thanks for everybody to, once he sends out that doodle poll, getting your information back to him. So before our next meeting, we do want you to kind of look at, it's long, we understand, so you don't have to read the whole thing unless you just are really into it. The whole natural hazards mitigation plan, the current one, it is on the website. Greg is also going to provide a focus matrix. And if you got the agenda on the, there are two things on the agenda. There's a link to the FEMA guide. And then also the second page includes all of the FEMA requirements. And this focus matrix goes through all those requirements. What we did well last time, where we could use improvements, and then some comments and assignments that we're going to be working through. So that would be your homework assignment. And then our next meeting, we want to focus on hazards identification and assessment. Also, once I send out your invitations to the BOX program, please get familiar with that. And then time reporting. Participants coordinate with Greg for your time reporting, or he will coordinate with you on what code to use. So we've got some latecomers.
The update focus list. It is actually in the chat. I linked that document. We will end up putting that on the website as well. But this is just a great resource that kind of tells us what we need to do, what it says in the regulation, what's new from previous, if there were comments from the 2017, whether it's strengths or improvements, and then some of our suggested suggestions and assignments as we move forward. And that's really what we're going to be working on as we continue to be successful and update this plan.
Great. Does anybody have any other comments, questions? Raise your hands, forever hold your peace, whatever that term is.
I think, I scheduled us for a lot longer than we needed, fortunately. In the future, we will probably need more time to work through and talk through some of these specific hazards, the identification of those, the risk assessment and everything. So I think unless anybody has any other comments, you're welcome to stay on. please, if you joined us and you didn't get an invite directly from me, please send me an email. Let me just put make sure everybody. Sorry. So my email is in the chat. There's a few of you that looks like you probably had the invite forwarded to you. So if you did not get it directly from me, please make sure you send me an email with your information so we can continue to keep you updated and keep you on the list. And again, if you have any details or anybody else that should be participating in this that you think would be benefiting, either from actively participating in the update, the risk assessment, et cetera, or if it's just good for them to be informed of what's going on, again, please provide that information. Otherwise, we will continue. I'll send out a doodle poll here shortly, and we will see you all in the near future for some great planning and development of this natural hazard mitigation plan update. And again, as Cynthia said, please take a few minutes and at least look through our current natural hazard mitigation plan. It is pretty robust. It's 200 and some odd pages. Lots of graphs, lots of images, but still it's quite the document to go through. So please, if you can take a few minutes and scroll through that, take a look at it, and we will set up the next meeting here in the near future. Thank you all very, very much for joining us. Cynthia, do you have anything else, or Marion?
No, I'm fine. I think it went by quicker because we didn't open it up to for communication. So, but the chat has been monitored. So thanks everybody for your input, and we will see you in the near future. Thanks, Patricia.
Okay. Marion, anything from you? Okay. Well, thank you all very, very much for joining us. We'll see you here in the very near future. And please look forward to emails from me. And thank you all very much for participating. Have a good day.